We all know that molecular oxygen, O2, the thing in the air that we breathe, is produced by photosynthesizing plants, algae, and bacteria, things that use light to convert it to chemical energy and produce oxygen. Therefore, we would assume that oxygen is only produced at the surface of Earth where light can reach, right? Wrong. There was actually a study just a few weeks ago that found oxygen being produced at the seafloor where no light reaches. So just to give some quick background about oxygen on Earth, like I just mentioned, molecular oxygen, O2, not the element, the molecule, this thing that we breathe in to actually metabolize, to gain energy, to live, is produced by photosynthetic life, like plants, algae, and cyanobacteria. Before such photosynthetic life evolved to split water molecules and produce molecular oxygen, there was negligible molecular oxygen on Earth. In the atmosphere, in the oceans, there was very little to essentially no oxygen. It wasn't until about 2.4 billion years ago, during the Great Oxidation Event, or GEO, that oxygen began accumulating in appreciable amounts in the oceans and atmosphere of Earth. This was due to the spread of oxygen-producing photosynthetic life at the time. In this case, it was cyanobacteria. Plants and algae hadn't evolved yet, but these cyanobacteria had become so prolific by then and produced so much oxygen that had, you know, reacted with a bunch of other chemicals on Earth and then finally began building up as molecular oxygen, O2, in the atmosphere and oceans. And now on Earth today, two major processes drive the carbon and oxygen cycles. Photosynthesis, obviously, which consumes CO2 and water and produces organic carbon, their biomass, their bodies, and oxygen, which goes into the atmosphere or the oceans, and then we, animals, and other respiring organisms carry out what we call oxygen respiration, where we consume organic carbon and oxygen and produce CO2 and water. And this cycles nutrients and drives food chains on Earth. On land, this typically looks like trees and other plants at the surface producing organic carbon, which when they die is eaten and decomposed by soil microbes and other organisms within or on Earth's surface, which produce carbon dioxide, which kind of goes back into that cycle. So this helps cycle carbon through these ecosystems. And then this happens as well in oceans, where photosynthesizers at the sea surface, like algae or cyanobacterial blooms, produce organic carbon, which falls through the water column and is eaten and decomposed either within the water column or on the seafloor by respiring organisms, whether that be macro, you know, fish swimming in the water column, or microorganisms at the seafloor, which decompose that organic carbon and produce CO2, which goes back into the carbon cycle. All the while this is happening, our understanding of oxygen cycling is that production of oxygen happens at Earth's surface, whether that be at land surfaces with trees and plants, or at the ocean surface in the photic zone where light reaches with algae and bacteria. Whereas consumption of oxygen happens at depth, within the water column of the ocean, within seafloor sediments, in soils, and at Earth's surface. Whether light can reach or not, that's not a requirement for the consumption of oxygen, for oxygen respiration. Whereas for oxygen production, light is a requirement. So, in other words, no oxygen is being produced deep in the subsurface, or deep in Earth's interior, or on the seafloor where light can't reach. Or at least, so we thought. Marine scientist Andrew Sweetman and his team collected data, which was just published last month, June 2024, that showed that oxygen is being produced on the seafloor around 4,000 meters below the surface, where absolutely no light can reach. I found a quote from the lead scientist saying that he basically told his students to put the sensors back in the box and that they needed to be recalibrated because the data showing that oxygen is being produced at the seafloor cannot be right. In fact, the first time they observed this was in 2013, over 10 years ago. And since then, they've gone back and observed this phenomenon many times over in many different locations over a large area that extends over 6,400 kilometers. And now they recognize it as a real phenomenon that isn't due to faulty equipment. They've checked many times for the past decade, and they're calling it dark oxygen. Essentially oxygen that's being produced in the absence of light. So how does dark oxygen form where there's no light and obviously no photosynthesis is possible? Well, a series of experiments done on the samples this team of scientists collected suggests that it's not biological. So now they've turned to the reason that they were there collecting samples in the first place. Polymetallic nodules. Nodules are concretions that form on the seafloor that contain multiple metals. These nodules are important, or rather the metals they contain are important, for green energy technology and therefore have big incentives in terms of mining. The original focus of the expedition was actually to research the area and its biodiversity, as well as the accumulation of these nodules to get a sense of whether it should be mined or not. These nodules are so useful because the metals that they contain are used to make batteries. But what if they could also be acting as kind of natural batteries in their natural environment on the seafloor? Could this allow them to be producing molecular oxygen through some sort of electrochemical reaction? It turns out, yeah. When placed into salt water, electric current from a battery can split water molecules through electrolysis. So just like photosynthesizers use energy from light to split water, this can happen abiotically through electrolysis. We just need essentially an anode and a cathode, something to create an electric current. So they measured the voltages from the nodules and they saw that they produced up to 0.95 volts, which is less than the 1.5 required for seawater electrolysis, but might be enough when nodules are all clustered together on the seafloor. And they're now calling these dark oxygen producing nodules GEO batteries. I do want to note here, this study is still very new and there's a lot of other competing hypotheses out there for how the oxygen is actually getting formed. This is just their initial idea. I did see some other work that had been done that showed that dark oxygen might form in soils from cellular, so biological processes. So there's still a lot of work that needs to be done to confirm whether these are actually produced by abiotic or biological processes. In any case, it doesn't take away the fact that it is happening. Oxygen is being produced in the absence of light on the seafloor, whatever's causing it. And this is a really important discovery. Why? Why does this matter? Well, for a multitude of reasons, but the first being that it kind of challenges our whole fundamental understanding of how oxygen is produced and consumed. The traditional produced at the surface and consumed at depth model now has the added complexity of production at depth. And this kind of reshapes our whole understanding of oxygen evolution on Earth as well. And I'm so interested in this because this was the topic of my entire PhD dissertation. Now, it doesn't undo the research I did or anybody else has done in this area of oxygen evolution on Earth. However, it does add a factor for us to consider when we look at proxies or signatures in the rock record that indicate to us past ocean oxygen levels. In other words, going forward, as we look at signatures in the rock record, we now have to consider that the oxygen levels indicated by whatever proxy we're looking at might include some localized anomalies of oxygen production due to nodules, if nodules formed in abundance in those regions. So we just kind of have to look at the type of rock that we're looking in for these proxies and understand whether that would have formed in association with these polymetallic nodules, and if so, what that means for our reconstructions. I actually published a paper last year with a group of scientists from the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution about reconstructing past oxygen conditions using thallium isotope signatures as a proxy, and where thallium isotope signatures would be preserved is in these nodules often. So looking at signatures preserved within the nodules that might be producing oxygen themselves could be now a little bit more problematic than it used to be. But anyway, that's like a whole nother side topic I could do another video on. If you want to check out my paper, I'll link it down below. In any case, this finding of dark oxygen at the seafloor might also change how we study the origin of life on Earth. Why? Well, life might have originated in the deep sea, specifically in hydrothermal vent environments, where a lot of chemicals are being produced within the hydrothermal vent and released through hydrothermal vent fluid, which is entering the ocean and reacting with all the stuff that's in the ocean. And this kind of chemical interface creates a lot of energy possibilities for life. In other words, these chemicals that are being released into the ocean through the hydrothermal vent fluid can provide energy for life. Essentially, life can use them to harness these reactions that are going on to gain energy. However, now that we know that oxygen is being produced at the seafloor, this adds a level of, well, maybe life didn't get its start near hydrothermal vents at all. Maybe it could get its start in like a nodule-rich area of the seafloor. However, my thoughts on this are still mixed. My initial thought when I was reading about this finding and how they were relating it to being significant for the origin of life on Earth was it isn't really significant for studying the origin of life on Earth because we know that primitive life didn't metabolize oxygen. It wasn't until way later, after photosynthesizers evolved and produced the abundance of oxygen in the atmosphere and oceans, that allowed then the evolution of oxygen metabolizing life like ourselves and other animals to evolve. So this initial thought was essentially, no, it really doesn't matter that it was being produced at the seafloor because that kind of life didn't even evolve until way later, so it wasn't the first life on Earth. However, then I thought, well, I also didn't think that any oxygen was really produced in appreciable amounts until after photosynthesizers evolved, and now that is kind of being changed potentially. So I don't know if this is just my biased way of thinking, but I still think that our oxygen estimates of early Earth still stand based on all the proxies that we've collected, and therefore I imagine that this seafloor nodule production of oxygen would have been negligible on early Earth and wouldn't have really contributed to the origin of life. But I don't know, maybe that's just my biased way of thinking or my old-fashioned way of thinking. I'm not sure. So this finding changes the way we study past and present ocean chemistry, as well as potentially the origin of life on Earth. But how does this affect us directly, and why should we care? Well, although the study was ironically funded by mining companies, the finding of dark oxygen has made the researchers hesitant when it comes to mining these nodule-rich regions. We know that regions of the seafloor that were mined in the 80s still have not seen biotic recovery, even full bacterial recovery, whereas life in unmined regions is flourishing. And given that the biodiversity in nodule-rich areas of the seafloor are higher than even most tropical rainforests, we should probably hold off mining these regions. Especially considering oxygen is being produced there, potentially supporting higher life than we had previously thought. Now, does that mean we won't mine there? Probably not. People will probably end up doing it anyway. But that's kind of the main takeaway I got from the study. So I hope you guys enjoyed learning about this amazing new discovery. And if you want to check out the study as well as other references, they are linked in my description box below. And with that, I will see you guys in my next one. Bye. Hope, look at the camera. Hope. Not gonna happen.